So, a few things going on with the Montreal Canadiens and their defense. This is our topic of the video, and we have ourselves a few discussion points that I wanted to highlight here. Firstly, starting with Carey Price. Dominic Ducharme says Carey Price will not be able to practice with the Canadiens before the season starts. He said they'll ease him back in once he recovers from his illness. Now, we don't know what exactly that is. All we can do is wish for a speedy recovery for Carey Price. Honestly, just kind of be happy that he's even still here with the Canadiens. Either way, though, when it comes to Carey Price and him being out, we said it in the video that I recorded that Metro 10th. This is kind of the reason they claimed Samuel Montembeau off of waivers from the Florida Panthers, mostly because if Carey Price were to not be able to start out the year, we would have a tandem of Allen and Montembeau. No Poulin over here, no Primo, just have the two NHL guys that are actually NHL caliber step up and play in that role. Allen, I'm good with Allen. I like him a lot. Everybody kind of knows that I've had this kind of admiration for Allen ever since the 2020 bubble with St. Louis. And for Montembeau, I mean, it's a new face. He's going to be in here. He's probably a lot better than Poulin and Primo anyway. So having him as a backup while Carey Price is out is certainly not a bad idea. However, the bigger thing that I wanted to talk about in this video revolves around the defense. We had ourselves an update as well talking about Joel Edmundson, saying that he will miss 2 to 3 weeks from today. Further testing with the Canadiens was not very good, which isn't a good sign, you know. With Edmundson being out, we leave this Canadiens decor in a pretty fragile state. Especially if you take a look at what else has happened with this lineup, involving guys like Sami Niku, for example. And so now, when you take a look at the way the Canadiens' D-Core is assembled, this is kind of how things go down. You have yourselves Ben Chiarot, Jeff Petry, Alexander Romanov, David Savard, Chris Wideman, Brett Kulak, Kaiden Guhle, and Mattias Norlinder. Everybody else is just kind of either injured or day-to-day. Weber, of course, is the long-term one. You have Edmundson and Niku who are here as well. This is pretty much what the D-Core looks like, and if I'm going to be honest, there are some concerns that you can bring up with the way this is assembled over here. Now, I think everything is kind of summed up really well in this comment from the post-game thread on our Habs from yesterday. This is what user LeCoupe25 said. I thought it was a really interesting perspective. The Habs have a big problem on D this season. Edmundson may be out for a while. We now know it's 2 to 3 weeks. Romanov and Wideman both look like they belong in the AHL. Niku is injured. Savard will be playing above his level in terms of minutes. Guhle looks much better than Romanov to me. I like Samuel Montembeau, he should be an okay backup until Price can play. The beginning of the season will not be pretty. Also, they talk about the face-off, Suzuki 50%, Poehling and Perreault at 58%, and Jake Evans at 69%. Really nice over there, Jake Evans. But I do think the D-Core needs some addressing, because this assembly over here certainly does bring up some concerns when you try to look at where this team goes at the start of the year. The forwards are okay. We know everybody is pretty all right with the way the forwards are assembled. Once Caulfield and once Hoffman come back, everybody should be good to go. Byron as well. My goodness, how did I forget about him? But this team is all right up front. In net, I said it, I think Price is all good, but give him a while. Allen Montembeau, I'm all right with that tandem as well. But for the D cores, Jeff Petry is now all of a sudden the de facto number one guy on this blue line. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Everybody kind of knows that Petry is capable of being a top of the line defenseman, especially on this Habs team. It's just before, he was never really the guy. He had to share it out with Shea Weber, who would log like 25 plus minutes a night. But those Weber minutes being taken up with a guy like David Savard instead is gonna be a pretty interesting shift. Mostly because David Savard played his most recent seasons with the Columbus Blue Jackets, where he was mostly a top four guy. It got even worse when he played over with the Lightning, because with the Lightning, I mean, he was playing on the third pairing with Mikhail Sergachev. The Lightning were not afraid to use all the other guys they had over Savard. So to go from a bottom pairing defenseman with the Lightning like Savard was, granted it was a Stanley Cup championship caliber team, all the way to now where he's going to be splitting the number one load on the right side with Jeff Petry, it's going to be really strange seeing how good David Savard transitions into that role right away. You know, he's not really used to being as highly deployed as he is going to be with Shea Weber out and with Jeff Petry also splitting that load. You also have yourselves the rest of the concerns in the lineup here too. Chris Wideman playing as the final right-handed defenseman on this squad so far. I said in the previous video, he kind of gives me Eric Gustafson vibes, you know? You don't really rely on him for anything aside from his power play abilities, and quite frankly, I'm not all too surprised. We said this in the video all the way back when he was signed, man. Wideman was a great KHL defender who could produce points like there was no tomorrow, but Just because you're good at producing at the KHL level does not guarantee anything in the National Hockey League. It's a different game. It's faster. It's tighter. You don't have as much room to think. It's a lot more instinctual right there. And so, for Chris Wideman to come in here as the power play guy and do his business over there, but also struggle out of the power play, it does not surprise me one bit. It will be interesting to see if the Canadiens decide to actually keep him up with the team, play him in a power play role, have him as the number one guy with Shea Weber out or whatever, or just maybe suit him up as a seventh defenseman, not really have him in the lineup all too much at all, and maybe only suit him once in a while when there are extra injuries on the team. And so that kind of wraps up the right side. Next up for the left defenders, as we said, Edmundson out 2 to 3 weeks, so he's not going to be here to start off the year. Ben Chiarot is pretty much your de facto number one left-handed defenseman now. And he's probably going to stick around in that role. I mean, he's not used to it, you know? Chiarot-Weber was a pairing for a while in the playoffs, and for Weber to be out and Chiarot splitting the load with Petry instead, it's not really going to be all too much of an adjustment for him. As for Romanov, Kulak, Guhle, and Norlinder, well, things start to really scramble itself up when you start to say, all right, we have two more left-handed defensemen spot that we have to fill out in this team, and we have four guys that could potentially fill it. Now, aside from Alexander Romanov, there probably isn't really too much of a guarantee for any of these guys. And even for Alexander Romanov, as the comment that we highlighted earlier stated, he hasn't really been looking all too great in this preseason. We've seen a lot of things that kind of indicate to us why the Canadiens were so reluctant to play him in the postseason last year in these games this year. A lot of pinches have been really improper. Some of the plays that he has made in his own zone have been kind of questionable. Alexander Romanov still has a lot more development to go through, so I definitely don't want to get down on him in that respect, but I'd be lying if I said that he's looked amazing in this preseason so far. And it's to the point now where you got guys like Kaiden Guhle and Mattias Norlinder and Kulak over here as well that could honestly be realistically vying for spots against that Alexander Romanov in the lineup. I think by default Romanov's going to be there, but if you made the argument that other guys could play over him, I wouldn't necessarily disagree. For Kaiden Guhle, I always thought the entire time that the best course of action would have been to send him back to the Prince Albert Raiders. I definitely do think that he would develop properly in that system with an extra year rather than being forced into an NHL role, but I mean, if he's already a better option than some of the other guys you have, what other choices would you want to go out there and do? Because the Canadiens, at the end of the day, they just made the finals. They still want to be competitive. They don't want to go out there and make any moves, today at least. They don't want to choose any players that would make them a worse hockey team than other guys in their lineup. So if they did decide to keep Kaiden Guhle with the Habs because they legitimately do feel that he is better than the other options they have, then okay, but I don't really know if that would be the best course of action for the development of Kaiden Guhle, if you kind of catch my drift. Now, to be fair, I guess the Canadiens have kind of had that reputation of rushing prospects into the league anyway, but that's besides the point. Brett Kulak is still here. He's been Kulak. I mean, everybody kind of knows what Kulak is at this point. Solid bottom pairing guy. If you really don't have anybody else, Kulak is not a bad option. Mattias Norlinder, though, is interesting because he has been somewhat up and down throughout this preseason as well. There have been some moments where I've been absolutely dazzled by what Norlinder has done. In the offensive zone, seeing this guy skate around is pretty good, but as I said, this game is so all over the place that it's tough for me to say that he is a definitive lock to be on this team today. And so now, with Mark Bergevin and the decisions that you have to make at the helm, you have to ask yourself, where do you go from here? Do you say, okay, it's just going to be Romanov because he's used to playing here, we'll have Kulak in here as well, and then we'll just wait for Edmundson and or Sami Niku to come back, and then we'll send Wideman down to the AHL or whatever. There's a lot of flexibility over here, while also not having too much flexibility. The flexibility comes after Edmundson and Niku are back, and after you start out the regular season and actually get a feel for how these guys play under a full 82-game schedule. So I'm kind of concerned. Are you kind of concerned? Let me know in the comments, what do you think about the Montreal Canadiens and their defense core? Who would you have as the top six in the starting lineup, assuming Edmundson and Niku are both out? Romanov, Kulak, Norlinder, Guhle, let me know in the comments all your thoughts. I hope you enjoyed this. And bye.